And when he was declared righteous, we were declared righteous. And then he was made alive out of spiritual death. And when he was made alive, we were made alive. Because you see, we hung on that cross with him. We died with him on that cross. We were buried with him. He was not a martyr. He was our substitute. Amen. Jesus will never pray and say, "My God," never. It was always "Father." But on that cross, he said, "My God, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" Now, of course, God forsook him, because God is of purer eyes than to behold iniquity. And 2 Corinthians 5:21 says that God had made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin. So he was made sin. He was made sin. God had to look away. And then our sins, those are two different things. Our sin nature was laid upon his spirit. Did Jesus become a sinner? No. But God laid our sin nature upon his spirit. He was our substitute. And then all the sins of mankind were laid upon him as well. He got separated from the Father. And then if he hadn't died spiritually, he couldn't have died physically. He died. And where did he go when he died? The place where people separated from God go. That's where he went. He went to hell. I'm not talking about Abraham's bosom. He went to hell, hell. Yes, he later went to Abraham's bosom, but not that day. And what did he go to do in hell? He went to suffer in our stead. He paid that price. Remember, his deity were humanity. And 1 hour of deity suffering is worth more than an eternity of humanity suffering. And after those 3 days and nights, God looked at man's crime and man's treason, man's sins. And then he looked at Jesus' sacrifice. And then he said, "Yes, it's enough. He has satisfied the claims of justice. He has met the demands of the law." And then he was declared righteous right there. And when he was declared righteous, we were declared righteous. And then he was made alive out of spiritual death. And when he was made alive, we were made alive. Because you see, we hung on that cross with him. We died with him on that cross. We were buried with him. He was not a martyr. He was our substitute. Amen. And then he took Satan and he conquered him. He brought the devil to naught. He took sin and he conquered it. Amen. He arose triumphant over death, over hell, and over the grave. He's the one now who's got the keys of death and of hell. You know, by the time you've got the keys to your enemy's abode, you know, he's in soup. Amen. Jesus is the authorized one. He's the one with the authority. He redeemed us. He obtained eternal redemption for us. He redeemed us completely. Ephesians 1:7 says, "In whom we have redemption through his blood." You see, this season of Christmas is a time to look back at that redemptive work. It's a time to look back at the fact that man is brought back in union with God. That God and man are now united again. You see, Jesus is an incarnation, no doubt. But there's an incarnation, a real incarnation in the new birth. God is still made manifest in the flesh, in the new creature. If you're born again, you have the life and nature of God in your spirit. You have God's substance and being on the inside of you. And not just that, the Holy Ghost himself is living in you. He's making your body his home. He's making your body his abode. We are brought into vital union with God. And so you need not live a life of defeat. You need not live a life of sickness. You need not live a life of lack. You need not live a life of failure. You can take your place in Christ. You can fulfill the purpose of God. You see, that's what Christmas is all about. The fact that a man came, an incarnation, 100% God, 100% man. Man and God are united in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he came so that we might become sons of God. If you're born again, you're a child of God. You're born again, you have the life of God in your spirit. Colossians 1:12 to 14, it says, "Giving thanks to the Father, which hath made us meet," or who has made us able, "to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who has delivered us from the power of darkness, and has translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins." We have an actual redemption from the devil's dominion. Amen. Satan is no longer our Lord. Satan is no longer our master. Sin does not have authority over us. Bad habits don't have authority over us. Disease, you know, with some people, sickness is just a habit. Nothing but a habit. They're just sick as a habit. Listen, stop that habit. It's a bad habit. Amen. You don't have to walk in disease. You don't have to live in that realm. Why? Because of Christmas. My question to you today is this. Are you taking advantage of your redemptive rights in Christ? Are you taking advantage of all that Jesus purchased for us? Galatians 3:13 says, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us, for it's written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on the tree, that the blessing of Abraham, verse 14, might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the spiritual faith. So you see, we are redeemed from the curse of the law. And that curse is threefold: spiritual death, sickness and disease, and poverty. Poverty is a curse. It's part of the curse we've been redeemed from. Amen. Are you taking advantage of all that's yours? That's my question. First question. And my second question is this. What are you doing with the message of redemption? Are you telling the story? Are you sharing the good news? See, there are many on a fast lane to hell. Yes, you know, Christmas, we talk about how those gifts were given, we exchange gifts, and that's great. But listen, if all we do is exchange gifts, we've missed the import of Christmas. The greatest gift, really, is the gift of eternal life. What are we doing to see to it that somebody gets it? You know, it's the end of a year. How many people did you bring to Jesus this year? Don't tell me. What did you do? How effective were you in taking your place in Christ this year? Walking in purpose. Walking in close fellowship with God. How will you score yourself this year? Well, we can't do anything about the past other than to learn from it. But as we reminisce, as the year comes to a close, let's think back about Jesus. He's the reason for the season. Redemption, the finished work that he did. And I want you to propose in your heart that I'm going to take my place in Christ. I'm going to take advantage of my redemptive rights. I'm going to take advantage of my redemptive privileges. I'm going to walk in my dominion, in my authority, in everything that's mine. And I'm going to be a conduit of that same life, how somebody can come into Christ. Amen. Praise God. Well, I guess I'm done. You know, it's been a while we had questions with this session. So I just wanted to just share with us a little bit. You know, Christmas season, we usually talk about the baby, you know, then the baby, we bring the baby, we're talking about the baby, you know. We claim to be marking Jesus' birthday, and then it's always the baby. When we talk about Awolowo's birthday, we don't look for a picture of the baby, Awolowo. When we talk about Zeke's birthday, we don't look up the baby Zeke. No, we celebrate birthdays of people, right? Great people. What do we do? We talk about everything they stood for. Their life, their death, their legacy. Yeah, so why is it that? You see, I almost think it's the devil wanting us to just keep Jesus as a baby. Jesus is not a baby anymore. He's seated at the right hand of the Father. And thank God for gifts. And let's give all the gifts we can. It's great. It's good. But beyond that, don't let's make Christmas about rice. Don't let's make Christmas about parties. Yeah, nothing wrong with parties. Nothing wrong with rice. You know, rice is good. But let's not forget, it's about redemption. Taking our place and helping somebody else to find Jesus and to take their place. Amen. Questions? Thoughts? Comments? Someone said to me the other time, he said, it's been a while we asked questions. After the teaching, somehow we haven't had enough time. So, questions. I said enough to generate some questions. Be strong in the Lord. Be strong in the Lord. You know, God won't tell us to do what we can't do. So if God says be strong, it's because we can be. That means you can be weak if you want to. You can be a weak believer if you want to be a weak believer. It's up to you. But God doesn't want us to be weak believers. In Psalm 27 verse 1, the Bible says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?" So you see, He's our strength. He's the strength of our lives. And that's why the Bible says, be strong in the Lord. Be strong in the Lord.